Okay, welcome to this lecture where we will define infinite dimensional Lie groups. So this is the third chapter with the title Lifting Geometry to Mapping Spaces. And because our purpose in the end will be to construct the so-called current groups, which allow us to lift Lie group structures from a target Lie group to a space of mappings. However, before we do so, let's first define what possibly infinite dimensional Lie group is. So what do we mean actually by this notion of infinite dimensional Lie group? Okay, and so let's define first what we mean by that. And well, the definition is relatively straightforward. So definition. Group G is called a Lie group if G is a manifold, let's say modeled on a locally convex space in the Bastiani sense. And this manifold structure turns the group operations into smooth maps. So we have the multiplication, of course, which we denote by mg, something g times g, taking values in g. And well, we are usually using the standard notations. So we're just sending it to x times y, or we even leave out the dot. And then we have the inversion. So mapping from G to G, X gets sent to X inverse. So these two mappings should be smooth. And one also, so also useful or usual notation, I should say, is to say in this case, G is a locally convex Lie group, which is purely introduced. So this adjective locally convex just means that it's that the group is possibly infinite dimensional modeled on a locally convex space. So we will usually drop the locally convex moniker here and just say it's a Lie group, because for us it will play no role whether this Lie group will be finite or infinite dimensional. I mean, for the theory, it makes a difference, but we will always assume, I mean, if nothing else is said, we will say that the Lie group is possibly infinite dimensional. Let's just fix some notation for later use in this chapter. So if G is a group, then we say that 1G is the unit element. And if the group is clear, we also write one. And also we do this with the other structural maps. So if a map M without an index is appearing, then usually the group will be understood. And so there are some other mappings we want to be looking at. So if G is a fixed element in the group, then I always will denote by lambda G the left translation with G, so where H gets sent to GH, and rho G will be the mapping, the right translation, where H gets sent to HG, right? And let's observe that if I have lambda G applied to rho H of X, this is by definition. So we have to multiply H from the right and G from the left. And we see that these two mappings commute actually with each other. So we can exchange the the order in which they are applied. Note that this, of course, is no statement about commutativity in the group. It's just that if we multiply first from the left and then from the right, it's the same as if we multiply first from the right and then from the left. Right? So there's nothing here about commutativity. So the groups will in general be non-commutative. Anyway, let's see some examples for these Lie groups. And the first zeros example, if one wants, is a locally convex space E is a Lie group with respect to vector addition and the usual manifold structure. So meaning we are thinking of this of the locally convex space as a manifold with respect to the identity chart. And since this is an abelian group, we call E an abelian Lie group. Okay, I mean, this is the easiest example. So in case you haven't seen finite dimensional Lie groups, let's make some finite dimensional examples to set the tone of this exposition. So basically these examples fall under the classical finite dimensional Lie theory. So they will probably be covered in any course on Lie theory. So, and I mean, the standard example is we let Mn be the set of all real n times n matrices. And GLN R, this is then the set of all matrices, all square matrices, such that the determinant of A is not equal to zero, so of all invertible matrices. And then it's easy to see, well, I mean, on one hand, this is also covered in all of the standard courses. We know that the set of all matrices just can be identified with the vector space R to the n square. And since the determinant is a continuous mapping, I mean, we can just write it as something in the matrix entries. So we get so GLNR is now the inverse image under this continuous map of the open sets of the reals where we have excluded zero. And so this is an open subset of MNR. So it becomes a manifold. And now what we know from the usual how matrix multiplication works. So matrix multiplication is basically given by a polynomial in the entries of the matrices. This is smooth with respect to this open submanifold structure, also inversion. For inversion, we can use Cramer's rule, which also shows that inversion is up to dividing by the determinant polynomial in the entries of the matrix, so it's smooth. And what this implies is that GLNR is a Lie group. However, we will see this as a, if we want a complete proof, so this can also be seen as a special example of the example which is coming later. So we will see this later. This is since the matrix algebra is a Banach algebra, so what was a Banach algebra again? It's a Banach space. I mean, okay, Banach space is clear. However, what one usually also sees in one of the basic courses, so that we can find a norm inducing the topology such that for all pairs of matrices, if I multiply A with B, this is less or equal than the norm of A multiplied with the norm of B. So we got to find a submultiplicative norm on all these matrices. And this turns it into a Banach algebra where the multiplication is continuous versus and we have this submultiplicative norm, and inversion turns also out to be continuous, let's say for example by using the Neumann series. Sorry, not Neumann, Neumann. And right, so we can, if you want, see this as an as a special case of the example which is coming up later. However, these matrix Lie groups, they are quite quite important as finite dimensional examples, so they turn out to be not as important in infinite dimensions. Anyway, it's good to have, I mean, for a sanity check whether one should expect some behavior in a Lie group, these matrix Lie groups are often excellent sort of first examples to look at to see whether one should believe in some properties claimed for Lie groups. So by just studying the related property first for matrix Lie groups. Okay, so second example, again, since this is a review of some finite dimensional, just to give you a flavor, this is not, sorry, not the special orthogonal, it's the orthogonal group. ON of R, we take all invertible matrices such that A times A transpose is the identity. And this is a, or well, this turns out, or one can prove, this is a closed submanifold of G and R, and this structure turns it into a Lie group. Right. So, I mean, I don't want to talk too much about finite dimension Lie groups, just to give you some flavor. So these, all these classical matrix groups turn out to be Lie groups. And last example, which we will encounter later on in the mapping space context. So if you take the circle, the unit circle in R2, this is a submanifold. We have seen in earlier chapters that the unit sphere of a Hilbert space is a submanifold. And well, if we want to take out the big gun, then S1 is the unit sphere in the Hilbert space R2. How do we get a multiplication? Well, we know that we can identify R2 with the complex numbers, and then complex multiplication induces a smooth group structure on S1, right? And we can, so in other words, S1 is a Lie group. So those were the finite dimension examples, which are presented basically just for flavor. Let's now return again to some infinite dimension examples, and let me show you the most prominent Lie group which one encounters when going to this locally convex convex setting, because the following example cannot be made in a sense in a suitable way into a Banach into a Banach Lie group. So if we have a compact manifold M, then we can define the group of all smooth diffeomorphisms. So those are all F in C infinity functions from M to M, such that there exists a G in the C infinity functions with, sorry, from M to M with the property that F composed with G is the identity is G composed with F. And well, so we have all the mappings which are, which can be smoothly inverted. And so this is the diffeomorphism group. Where the group structure is given by composition. So group multiplication is composition of functions. And now with some work, one can show that the diffeomorphism group is actually an open subset of the smooth functions from M to M endowed with a compact open C infinity topology. And we know that the space on the right hand side, so this is an infinite dimensional manifold, one of these manifolds of mappings. And right, so proving that the diffeomorphism group is an open subset is somewhat painful, because what one has to do is one has to show that the compact open C infinity topology controls mappings being injective and surjective, and this can be done with some care, but the argument is a little bit ugly. So if you look into the lecture notes, there are references, say for example this is done in the book by Kriegel and Michor, The Convenient Setting of Global Analysis, that's the book title, sorry. And it's a bit awkward to show this. However, we already know that the composition mapping from the C infinity functions M times M times the C infinity functions from M times M with values in the C infinity function from M times M is smooth, since we know that, well, the manifold C infinity MM is not only an infinite dimensional manifold, but also falls into this category of, so this is a canonical manifold of mappings. And for canonical manifold of mappings, we know this behavior already. So this shows that the group product is smooth. Inversion, again, there's a nice argument in this setting in using the exponential law and then the inverse function theorem on the finite dimensional manifold M. So there one can give an argument there. And this is again done in the Convenient Setting book by Kriegel and Michor. So we're not doing it here. So we are actually, so let's just say one can show that inversion is smooth when diff M suspect to the composition product is a Lie group. And this is one of the most important examples of an infinite dimensional Lie group. And note that by construction, we have a canonical group action on the base space, so which is just given by, you take a diffeomorphism, you take a point, and then you evaluate this. And so this is a Lie group action, meaning it's a group action which is smooth, right? This is just the restriction of the evaluation map. And we know that this is smooth, the evaluation map, because the manifold structure on the C infinity functions is canonical. Okay, so this Lie group structure is quite important, as many different things. So for example, certain partial differential equations lead to ordinary differential equations on the diffeomorphism group, and often one can understand questions from finite dimensional differential calculus. So for example, when we care about flows of diffeomorphisms flows of differential equations, flows of vector fields or something, we can identify these as curves and as elements on the diffeomorphism group. So this infinite dimensional group Lie group structure then clarifies what we mean by smoothness in this context. Okay, so this is the important example, and we are omitting a lot of the details here. Right, so now on to the example I was already talking about. So basically what we want to do in this example, we want to generalize matrix Lie groups. So let's recall the notion of a continuous inverse algebra and since this is long we usually shorten it to CIA. So let A be a locally convex space together with a continuous bilinear map beta from A times A with values in A. And again, we write shorter BXY just as a product of X and Y, turning A into an associative unital algebra with unit 1a. So the meaning of this is, of course, if I multiply 1a with an x, I get x. This is the same as x multiplied from the left with 1a, from the right with 1a. Right, so we require the associativity and the unit. We call A, continuous inverse algebra, so allow me to write CIA, if the unit group A times, this is the set of all X in A, such that there exists an element X inverse in A with the property that X times X inverse is the unit is the same as X inverse times X. So if this unit group is open in A and the inversion, let's also call this guy iota. So this is something from the unit group with values in the unit group sending X to X inverse is continuous. So this is a continuous inverse algebra, an algebra which satisfies all of these properties. And so that's several remarks. So continuous inverse algebras generalize Banach algebras. And in this case, if you would think of the Banach algebras as a generalization of matrix algebras, then they also generalize matrix algebras, and they form a nice class of infinite dimensional algebras. And the reason why we are interested in this, and this is an exercise to show, it's not hard to do this, is the unit group of a CIA is a Lie group. So note here, since we know that the product is continuous and bilinear, it's smooth in the Bastiani setting. So it remains smooth after we restrict it to this open subset. And really the question here is smoothness of the inversion. And there's a beautiful argument of how we can do this. But this is left as an exercise. Okay, and these CIAs are important examples of infinite dimensional Lie, or the unit groups of CIAs are important for, examples of infinite dimensional Lie groups. And the reason why we just can't, or why we need this concept of a continuous inverse algebra, note that in the Banach context, we have a nice topology on the space. So let's say if E is a Banach space, or actually it would be sufficient to have just a normed space, we can look at the continuous linear mappings from E to E, and we can endow this with the operator norm coming from the Banach space norm. So this is a Banach algebra, and therefore it's also a CIA. So the unit group will be a Lie group modeled on a Banach space. However, if we go beyond, so here the important piece of information is that we actually have a Banach space. If we go beyond the Banach space setting, we are losing the operator norm, and one can prove that there's no good replacement for the operator norm. So this leads to the annoying situation of not having a good topology on the continuous linear mappings, or the continuous if you want to go to the subgroup or the Lie group, what should be the Lie group, that should be the invertible elements in this Banach algebra. And if we are losing the operator norm, there's just no good topology which turns the linear operators into a locally convex space, and makes, for example, the evaluation mapping continuous, which one certainly would want from a good topology. So one needs to take a different approach to how to generalize these Banach algebras, because sort of the linear operators will not support any good topology, and continuous inverse algebras are the way to go. Okay, so these were now two of the most prominent examples of infinite dimension Lie groups. So let's continue a little bit with some basic Lie theory. Let's define two things. First of all, we want to so let G1 and G2 be Lie groups. A group morphism. So let's say F from G1 to G2 is a Lie group morphism if F is smooth. Right, so Lie group is group plus manifold structure turning the group operations into smooth mappings. Lie group morphism is a group morphism which is smooth with respect to the manifold structures. Okay, and the second thing I wanted to define is if G is a Lie group, H sitting inside of G a submanifold, H is called Lie subgroup if H is a subgroup of G. And note, we had this lemma that if we restrict smooth mappings which take the image in a submanifold, then they stay smooth if they were smooth as a mapping into the large manifold. So what this implies is Lie subgroups become Lie groups with respect to the submanifold structure and the group operations. So we can just restrict everything. This preserves smoothness of the operations. One last thing. So if H is a closed subset of G, we call H a closed Lie subgroup. Okay, why am I stressing this? So if G is a finite dimensional Lie group, there is a very useful structure result, which implies that if H is a closed subgroup, then automatically the H has a submanifold structure. This is not an implication. So if finite dimension Lie group and we have a closed subgroup, then this implies that H is a Lie subgroup. So basically we get the submanifold structure just from the closedness. However, it's important to note this is a consequence of the group being finite dimensional. This is really, really important. Let me give you an example of a nice infinite dimensional Lie group, which is not, which has a closed subgroup, and the closed subgroup is not a Lie subgroup. Okay, so we consider the Hilbert space. Of all square summable functions with the addition as a Lie group. So we have this abelian Lie group. This was example 3.1.2. So, and we define a subgroup H. This is all the Xn, all the sequences, and all the square summable sequences such that the nth term in the sequence is the multiple of an integer by 1/n, right? So it should be sitting inside of this discrete subset 1/n in Z. Okay, now the projections pi j from L2 to R. And what they do, they take xn and n and just send it to xj. So they are continuous linear. And why do we care? Well, we can write the H as the intersection of all j and n of pi j inverse 1/j of z. And since these 1/j times z, those are the closed discrete subsets of the reals. And so we see that because we have their pre-images under continuous mappings, and then we take the intersection. So this is a closed subset of L2. And again, it will be an exercise to show that H is not a submanifold of L2. So we endow H, of course, with the subspace topology. We will see that the subspace topology is not discrete. So in every neighborhood of zero in the subspace topology, we will find elements which are non-zero. However, it will turn out that the H is not even locally path connected. And thus, it cannot be isomorphic to an open subset of a locally convex space. And well, if it's not locally isomorphic to an open subset of a locally convex space, then it cannot be a manifold. If it's not a manifold, it cannot even be a Lie group. So H is not a Lie subgroup. Okay, and here we have a very easy example of an infinite dimensional Lie group. I mean, the ambient Lie group L2 is just a vector space. And we have a closed subset, or a closed subgroup. Yeah, so it's, and this closed subgroup is not a Lie subgroup. All right, now let's prove another structural lemma, before we conclude this chapter. So 3.1.8. Lemma says the following. So let G be a Lie group. And we identify as always when we have the tangent space of G times G. This is of course canonically identified with the tangent space of G times the tangent space of G. And so we now have two statements. The tangent map of the multiplication so TMG, formally this is defined on T of G times G, but as we said, we can identify this with TG times TG going into TG. And what it does, so if I have an element sitting at, sitting at the point VG and WH, so the subscript will always denote the base point, then what is the formula for evaluating the tangent map at these two elements? Well, it's basically we can use the rule on partial derivatives, and so what this is TG rho H VG plus TH lambda G V WH. So this induces, okay, and this the statement is this induces a Lie group structure on TG with identity element zero at the unit. So this is an element in the tangent space at the identity of G, and inversion. So this the inversion mapping is the tangent space, the tangent map of the inversion mapping of the group. So this is going from TG to TG, and so the what we are going to prove is if we have a vector V sitting at G, then this is minus T rho G inverse T lambda G inverse of VG. Before we continue, let's have a little sanity check. But this makes sense. I mean, at least the signature. So we know by definition, so the VG is sitting at a point TG or at the tangent space of a point TG of G. Now, what happens if we use this mapping, so the left shift? If we're using the left shift, then we're going into T1G because we are left shifting with the base point G inverse. And if we compose G with G inverse, then we are at the tangent space of the identity. And then we are composing with the left, with the right shift, with the inverse. We are at, again, when we compose the identity with G inverse, then we are at the tangent space of G inverse of G. So at least this formula makes sense because we are going in the right tangent space. And obviously, we have to prove also that the concrete formula is correct, but at least this mapping transports things from the tangent space at G into the correct tangent space. Okay, so before, let's continue. So we are still not done. The bundle projection. Pi G from GG to G becomes a Lie group morphism with kernel. Well, I mean, what gets sent to one? So the kernel is the whole tangent space at the identity. However, the additional information is that the group product on the on this kernel is just given by the usual addition, and the zero section from G to TG sending a G to the zero element in the tangent vector in the tangent space above G, so is also a morphism. Of Lie groups. Which satisfies the relation. If I compose pi g with a zero section, then I get, of course, the identity on g. Okay, so this is the first part of the theorem. Let us, before we turn to this, before we turn to the second part, let's perhaps prove or give a sketch a proof, because a lot of the things here will be left as an exercise to check the details. On one hand, so the group axioms can be checked using the chain rule. Yeah, so for example, if we have associativity, so then this is mg of x, mg of y, z is the same as mg of x, y, and then I have to take mg of this with z. So this is the associativity. If this holds for all x, y, z, in G, we know that the group is associative. And basically what we can do now is we can apply the tangent to all of this. So this is TMG of, let's say, 0x, TMG of 0y, 0z. Well, this should be the same. And now this is a consequence of the chain rule as TMG of TMG of 0x, 0y, sorry, not 0, why am I doing 0 all the time? So we don't have this not only for the 0. The point is this works for every tangent vector, Vx, Vy, Vz. Again, we have Vx here, Vy, and Vz. Right, and this shows the associativity, and the rest of the group operations can be done similarly. Now, for the concrete formula of the multiplication, recall that we have the rule on partial derivatives. So this allows us to compute this as follows. So let's take a sneak peek above here. So we have so we want to derivate at in the left component. So we take the multiplication where we have not yet evaluated here in the left component and have to put in here an h, and then we have to evaluate this in w in vg, and similarly we take the multiplication where we have already evaluated in G but not in the right hand side, and then we evaluate in WH. And now the observation from this rule on partial derivatives is if I fix one element, so this just becomes left multiplication with H, not left, right multiplication, of course, right multiplication with respect to H. And this guy here is, of course, just left multiplication with respect to G. Right, and this gives the, so this formula for the multiplication map just gives us the formula we ask for above. Okay, let's make also a sanity check that the zero so TMG of 0, 1, what happens if I multiply this with WH? Well, on one hand we get T1 row H of 0, 1 plus TH M, sorry, left multiplication with the identity element of WH by the formula above. Okay, now the first guy here, so this one, so these tangent mappings, they are linear in the vector component, and we have just inserted a zero here. So what this shows is that the first thing just evaluates to zero, and the second guy evaluates to, well, what is the tangent mapping at of the left shift with the unit element, since the unit element is not changing anything. The left shift with the unit element is the identity, and then if we take the derivative of the identity, we get the identity, right? So we get WH. So this actually turns out to be the unit when with respect to left multiplication, and it's equally easy to see that it's also the unit with respect to right multiplication, right? It's the same computation, just that we reverse the that we flip the roles, the first and the second component. Okay, so this guy here really is a the unit, and then the last thing which we probably want to see is what happens if I take the tangent mapping at the unit times unit of the multiplication of something with of this kind. Well, then we have the tangent mapping at the identity, right multiplication with this guy, with the identity of V1 plus the same now with the left multiplication at the identity of W1. Well, and we have just argued above that if we take left and or right multiplication with the identity, with the unit, this is the identity mapping. So this really gives us V1 plus W1. And okay, so we see that really on the kernel of the of this mapping, so pi g, from TG to G, we have the we have that the the kernel of this mapping as a group multiplication, as a Lie group morphism, this is T1G, and multiplication in TG restricts to addition on T1G times T1G. This is what the computation above shows. Okay, right, so the rest of the verifications of these formula we leave as an exercise. So this was part A, and the upshot is that tangent bundle of a Lie group is again a Lie group. Okay, what is part B of the proposition? It's basically the following. So phi from G times the tangent space at the identity to TG, which just takes G and vector sitting at the identity and sends it to just the tangent multiplication of this vector with the zero vector, or I could also write for this T1 left multiplication with G of V1 is a diffeomorphism. And thus, so we can write, I mean, up to diffeomorphism induced by the left multiplication, the tangent bundle here can be written as a direct product of the base manifold times a vector space. So this is the assertion that TG is a trivial bundle, trivial vector bundle. Right? Okay. And how do we prove this? Well, on let's first note that phi can be written as TMG, and then you insert here. On one hand, we insert the zero section, and so takes g to the zero section of above g, and then we have to take here the identity of the space sitting here. So this is smooth, very nice. And let's just explicitly write down the inverse of this one. So what is phi inverse of an element v sitting at g? Okay, we have to produce an element in the group. Well, the only sensible thing to do here is probably to just project it down. So this is g, which is nice and smooth. And now we have to cook up an element at the tangent space of the identity from our map, from our vector vg. And how do we do this? Well, we can just compose it with tm of, we shift it from the left with g inverse, the zero here, the vg, or in other words, I could also say this is tg lambda g inverse of vg. And well, from the formula here, two things are clear. So this is a smooth mapping. And just by inserting the image of phi into phi inverse, we see and that phi inverse composed with phi is the identity on g times t1g, and similarly for the converse for phi composed with phi inverse. So this really shows that we have a diffeomorphism by phi, where we have used left multiplication to trivialize the bundle. Now one may wonder, so if we can use left multiplication, is there a reason to prefer left multiplication from, I mean, over right multiplication? Is there a similar morphism for the right multiplication, which allows us to trivialize a tangent bundle using right multiplication? And the answer is yes, of course there is. So there's no reason to prefer here left multiplication from the right instead of the right multiplication. So one gets a similar formula using the right multiplication. All right. And so I guess this is everything I wanted to say now in this first chapter on Lie groups. So we have seen some structure theory, we have seen some behavior which was unexpected perhaps, because in the infinite dimensional setting, for example, not all closed subgroups become Lie subgroups, and this is something which holds in finite dimensions. And we've seen some major classes of examples for these infinite dimensional groups, which are the diffeomorphism groups and unit groups of continuous inverse algebras.